This panel is about ethical challenges raised by conduct of prosecutors, defense counsel, legal commentators, maybe others, doing high-profile cases. But the focus really is going to be in what we've all been talking about and seeing for the last 2 years, the Mueller investigation. We're really lucky, as Brian said, to have my old friend Neil Eggleston on our panel. Neil was in the Southern District with me a long time ago, is at Kirkland and Ellis now, but also did a stint, which is very relevant to a later part of this discussion, in the White House counsel during the Clinton years, and then was the White House counsel, the last White House counsel for Obama, and really responsible for a lot of the clemency petitions and grants that we got from all the great work of the criminal justice section, lawyers like y'all. Gary Naftalis doesn't need an introduction. He's also out of the Southern District even longer ago than Neil and I, and is a partner at Kramer Levin, and really the dean of the White Collar Bar in New York and really elsewhere. Mythili Raman at the end here. I hope I didn't too butcher your name. I apologize in advance. She spent 18 years in DOJ, was acting head of the criminal division at one point, is at Covington now, and brings a wealth of experience. We have Jonathan Turley, who, if people turn on the television, people know Jonathan. He's a professor at George Washington, also a real lawyer that has been in a number of high-profile cases, many terrorism cases, brings a perspective that I think will be real balanced, to me at least, on the panel. And then we have former Congressman Trey Gowdy, who all of you recognize, who I did not know before this, but I've come to know and come to respect. He was in Congress, 4th District, South Carolina, from 2011 to 2019, where he served as chair of the Oversight Committee, was a member of the Judiciary Intelligence and Ethics Committees, interrogated most of the witnesses that we've seen in the Mueller investigation, including Michael Cohen, Donald Trump Jr., and many others. Currently, he's a partner at Nelson Mullins' firm in South Carolina. He had a previous career as a real lawyer, as an assistant U.S. attorney. He was what amounted to be the district attorney, elected for two terms in the Seventh Circuit in South Carolina, and was at a private firm as well. And unlike most of the members on your committees, and if who we've been watching live for the last couple of years, Trey knows how to ask a question. A few things. I suspect that few in the audience in the past several years haven't from time to time had serious misgivings about what is transpiring in our criminal justice system, from an ethics perspective, at least. I thought that the Mueller investigation and all its trappings would make a wonderful backdrop for a discussion of ethics in high-profile cases, or just an interesting discussion with panelists like this, which is what it's going to turn into, I think. Politics aside, it's incredibly interesting to shine a light on what we have been witnessing from the performance of defense lawyers, prosecutors, legal commentators, and we can throw in Congress in the last couple of years. Really, it all started, in my mind, it all started before the election with Director Comey, and we're going to talk about this at the end, having his extraordinary press conference discussing a non-prosecution decision by DOJ of a presidential candidate in seeming violation of longstanding DOJ policy. And we'll address that at the end, and y'all may have some comments as well. We've seen defense lawyers openly trash the Department of Justice, the special prosecutor, the FBI, not in motions, but in daily press conferences and social media. And, you know, we really need to talk about that and to think about that. We've observed an attorney secretly, we've observed prosecutors search a sitting president's attorney, as well as the president's one-time campaign manager. We've observed an attorney secretly tape record meetings with his client and then use it to try to make a better deal for himself, and recently testify in open session of Congress about his decade-long relationship, attorney-client relationship, at least in part, with his client, the president. We've observed a sitting president vilify the Justice Department, his attorney general, his deputy attorney general, the FBI, the special counsel, fire the director of the FBI, bemoan plea agreements and cooperators, and tweet during a highly publicized federal criminal trial about the overreach, in his mind apparently, of his prosecutors in the Justice Department and the unfairness of the charge. We've learned from the DAG and the acting FBI director apparently openly discussed, whether it facetiously or not, you know, wearing a wire in the White House. And throughout, we've heard from the president that the investigation by his Justice Department is a witch hunt. And unless you live under a rock, we have been watching 24-hour-a-day legal analysis, including occasional statements from so-called legal analysts, not anybody in this room, of course, that should make everyone's skin curl. So we'll explore these events, and as I said, we will take some time at the end to hear from y'all. Because we'd really, you know, this is what we talk about, so we might as well talk about it now. So, but let's first get the ethics out of the way, at least the implications of and the perils of social media and media in general in high-profile matters. So, our ethics expert, because I'm not one, is Lara Bazelon, who's a professor, who I didn't introduce. I'm sorry, Lara, at the University of San Francisco. And one of the leading professors in ethics in the country now, very active in this section. So, Laura, are there ethical limits that we lawyers have regarding what we can say in the media and on social media about a case? And maybe you could start with the ethics rules that apply. And before everybody else weighs in, tell us how they apply, whether they apply equally to all the lawyers, defense lawyers and the prosecutors.
So first of all, I want to start by saying thank you, Sandy, for including me on this panel. I feel like it's the kind of panel that would break the hearts of MSNBC hosts everywhere, so it's a real honor to be here. I realize I'm the part that's to be got over with, so with that understanding, here's my goal. My goal is to have roughly 75% of the room not be on their phone during the 3 minutes I'm going to talk to you. So. Here's what you need to know. The short answer, are there any limits? Not many. Here's why. The governing rule that we're talking about today is ABA Rule 3.6. It talks about pretrial publicity and the limits placed on lawyers on both sides so as not to, for example, contaminate the jury pool. So here's the standard that you need to know. Lawyers can't make public statements that are substantially likely to materially prejudice a case. That sounds like a real limit. Until you get to the exception. And the exception drives a truck through the rule, which is why we hear on a daily basis from everyone from Michael Avenatti to Rudy Giuliani. And here's the exception. The exception is lawyers on both sides can make public statements that they reasonably believe are necessary to protect their client from substantial, undue, prejudicial effects of recent publicity that they did nothing to initiate and that their client did nothing to initiate. So, if you want to construe this in the light most fair to these defense attorneys that Sandy has referred to who are going on television on a daily basis or tweeting or posting or Instagramming, the issue for them, and I understand this because I used to be a deputy federal public defender, is that once your client is indicted, once your client is publicly charged, even though, of course, there's a presumption of innocence, In all reality, that flies out the window, because what you hear from this very serious government official with the imprimatur of state authority is essentially that your client is being accused of something very serious, and the presumption really does, for all intents and purposes, flip, and your client is essentially presumed guilty, and you're behind the eight ball, because what the public is hearing is this ream of official charges, and so you need, in some ways, to fight back. What's complicated about all of this is Rule 3.6 is very antiquated, and so it never anticipated the fact that we live in the age of social media, and that it isn't really a question of getting invited, for example, as Mr. Turley often does, to speak on television. You don't need his platform to fight back. You just need to be on your phone, in your bathroom, tweeting about your case, and instantly, for free, you have access to millions of people who will then retweet your message. And so these rules never really contemplated the fact that almost anybody can access this digital platform, and that unlike, for example, a television appearance where you'll have opposing points of view, you have unfiltered access to make your own very specific case. Now, Sandy had also asked me to speak about, well, are there different pressures and constraints on prosecutors? And the answer is that they are. There are. And that may be one reason among many why we hear nothing from Robert Mueller. He speaks only through his indictments. And as I think we'll be talking about later on this panel, people like James Comey have come under great condemnation for the times that they have made more public extrajudicial statements, for example, about the decision not to indict Hillary Clinton. Prosecutors are held to a more rigid standard, and that is because, again, they have the power and the imprimatur of the state, and so anything that they say could very well materially prejudice a case, could cause the public to very much turn against the accused person, and so they're supposed to be held to a higher standard. And then finally, I will say that in addition to 3.6, the ABA has something called fair trial and public discourse rules, which are more constraining than the rules that I just described and are supposed to apply equally to both sides about not imputing the character of a client or a defendant, not talking about evidence that may or may not come into court. For example, not suggesting by your statements that you believe your client is guilty or innocent. You may be listening to all of this laughing because, of course, everyone is going on television talking about how their client is wrongfully accused, how this is outrageous, how this is a witch hunt. And I will just end the sort of ethics spiel by saying that those standards are aspirational. They are not enforceable. And so the short answer to your question, Sandy, are there any limits on what attorneys can do in the public sphere to advocate on behalf of their clients using all of the tools available to them? Not really.
So one final question before I open it up to everybody else. Is there a difference between statements made after an indictment and statements made before an indictment, even though you're the lawyer representing the target or whatever? Because in this case, obviously, many of the statements that we're going to talk about have been made by lawyers with regard to whether the president or, you know, Roger Stone or whoever, before there ever was an indictment. And then there are, of course, statements, and we'll talk about, that happened with, you know, after the indictment. Do the rules apply equally?
They don't. So the other thing is that the rule that I just spoke about, 3.6, is about pretrial publicity. Well, you know, for there to be pretrial publicity, there needs to be a trial, there needs to be a charge. And so the rules really trigger at that point. And what we're seeing so much today on television, all over social media, are people in the Trump administration, of course, Trump himself, and lawyers on the other side, talking publicly about cases that have not been indicted, cases that have not been brought, charges that could be brought. And in that case, the rules really aren't designed to apply to those particular situations. And again, I think this is a real question of sort of the ABA and other professional codes of responsibility not catching up to where we are now in this digital age of social media, where there's this ubiquitous access and ability to speak on behalf even of an unindicted or perhaps never to be indicted client, maybe in an attempt to make sure that that never occurs.
So are there, I mean, we hear talk about free speech. Let's take Roger Stone. You know, I have a right to free speech, I have a right to earn a living, versus fair trial and professionals we're talking about. I mean, Professor Turley, is there a conflict there that makes any sense?
I think there is a real conflict. You know, as radioactive as Roger Stone is, the issue of whether his book could be somehow restricted by the court does raise some First Amendment issues. I mean, he has a right to put out his account in that book. I think that Judge Jackson handled all of this very, very well and with great restraint. And I think Laura presented just a fantastic account of the ethics rules. I think the only thing I would add to keep in mind about pretrial stuff is that you also can be subject to a defamation lawsuit. And the courts have struggled with that in the same way that they've struggled with the rules that Laura's been talking about. You lose your absolute privilege in court once you step out of it and you make comments. And that's probably more of a real limitation on what we have to do in high-profile cases. There have been rulings against attorneys who have gone outside the courthouse, made comments that were considered defamatory. There's also been some litigation as to whether an intent letter before a filing can be the basis of defamation. And those things, there's some difference between how those play out in the States. So for example, Alan Dershowitz was just involved in this high-profile Second Circuit argument a couple days ago, where former Judge Cassell directly accused him of being a sex offender in the Epstein controversy. That's absolutely privileged. But if Paul walks outside the courthouse and makes that statement about Dershowitz, knowing both of them, I can pretty much guarantee that he'll be the subject of a defamation action. So that is something to keep in mind. But with regard to the First Amendment stuff, I am always troubled by, you know, the one thing that I don't think I disagree with Laura on, but the one issue that I would perhaps give an alternative view is, I think judges have gotten a little too aggressive on these gag orders. It used to be that the gag orders, when you look at Gentile and other cases, the gag orders was treated as an exception. Now, judges seem to routinely issue gag orders restricting attorneys. And it has a big impact on us. I mean, many of us have been in high-profile cases. We know that the first 72 hours is critical. So if you've got a client who's just being destroyed in the media, you've got about 72 hours to get his alternative view out. And you have to make some choices. The client, more importantly, has to make some choices. So, but these gag orders can be a real limit on that while they're taking these barbs. So, I had the Dr. Plague case, and Tom Butler in Texas. And the DOJ was all over that, slamming him for giving, you know, alleging that my client gave vials of plague to Al-Qaeda in Lubbock, Texas, like Al-Qaeda would come to Lubbock, Texas to get plague. What are you supposed to do in that? Just sit there and let him take it? Because if you win, he ends up being viewed as Dr. Plague.
Well, that's going to be my question to Neil and then to the other panelists. Do we lawyers have a duty to wage a public defense in addition or in conjunction with the traditional court defense? And, you know, do we have to push back with regard to what we routinely see or rules, you know, local rules that say you can't comment?
So, I mean, I agree with Professor Turley on this. I absolutely think that we have an obligation to push back. I have never pushed back the way it's happened in the Mueller investigation with an attack on the FBI and the judiciary and everybody. But I completely agree. And I'll just give a few examples of what's happened in my career. I've not had to confront, as you'll see in a minute from my examples, a gag order. But just a couple examples. First, obviously, when I was in the White House, it wasn't a criminal case, but getting our legal positions out so that the press and the public understood them. There's a huge machinery, like the ACA case. There's a huge machinery on the other side designed to inform the public, from our point of view, the wrong view of the ACA case. And so I was heavily involved in that. But two other more immediate examples. I represented Secretary Herman in the 90s when an independent counsel was appointed to investigator, and that's always a public event. And we decided we'd do a press conference after that appointment, and she went out and did a press conference. She gave her statement, and at the end of it, she said, and we won't say anything more about this. And I decided she needed to do it. I knew she was going to go to public forums all over the place. It was going to be where, you know, not to discuss that, but in her role as Secretary of Labor, she was essentially a public figure and she was going to be asked about it, and I needed to set a marker so she could say, basically, I've already addressed this, I'm not going to address it anymore, but I've already addressed this. If we hadn't done something, and also just to get her story out, she would have been harassed, and I think probably pretty effectively every place. The second example, and these tend to come up, you know, they're not that many cases that are persistent in their reporting. A lot of cases are reported the day of the indictment or something, but there's nothing like what's going on. But the other example is I represented the independent directors of Enron, which obviously the reporting went on for months. And I was quite active in the press, actually, because there was a lot of reporting about what had happened. I gave variations of the following statement over and over again. Not sure everybody knew it was the same statement over and over again.
So you were the Michael Avenatti of that time period?
Well, but I never went on TV. But basically, I said they were lied to. And they were lied to, and ultimately nothing ever happened to any of them because they were lied to by the executives. But I just couldn't sit there, and this is all pre-indictment. They were never indicted, obviously. But I just couldn't sit there and let the sort of press report episode after episode, day after day, and you remember it was sort of overwhelming coverage, without getting their response in there. And so I did. I didn't give massive interviews, but I went on the record and sort of gave their position over and over again. It was always, it came up in different fact circumstances, but I think we actually have a pretty strong obligation to do that.
Gary.
I would echo what Neil said. You know, we came from a background where we didn't do this. Right. We came from a background when we were in the U.S. Attorney's Office in the Southern District. You never talked to the press. You never said anything. And indeed, that was the mantra of people like Edward Bennett Williams, who was everybody's role model on the defense side, my generation. He never talked to the press about cases and the like. And that was how when I started on the defense side, I didn't talk to the press. You know, I either didn't take their calls or said I don't have anything to say. And one day in the middle of the insider trading cases, you know, back in the late 80s, early 90s, the big wave out of the Southern District, there was a leak about one of my clients. And I got a call from a prominent reporter from the Wall Street Journal, a very reputable, distinguished person. And I said, well, I have no comment. He said, you're making a mistake. He said, you're not helping your client. He said, I want to write a fair story. I want to hear what you have to say. You can tell it to me off the record, you can tell it to me on background, and I'll look into it, and I will try and write a balanced story. You may not like the story, net-net. And I said, oh, let me think about it. And he was someone of probity and integrity, and I talked to him. And it did change the story, and that incident changed my view of how I should represent my clients. I mean, which is to say, you may not, I mean, I'm not gonna be like Michael Avenatti, that's different, over the top. I can't want to go in that ballpark. But I mean.
Well, how about Rudy? Now, in fairness, Gary worked with Rudy and I worked for Rudy, so we know Rudy well.
No comment at this point. But. Also, Rudy's talking to another audience. I mean, you and I may or may not agree with his approach. His jury is not 12 people in a box, I think. His jury is the Republicans in the House of Representatives and the Senate and the base. I think that's who he's talking to. That's his jury, as far as I could tell. And whether that's effective or not, you know, we all could have views about all that, but I think that's his jury. But getting back to where I was, so I think that you got an obligation to speak for your client, whether it's on background, off the record, make statements and the like, because, you know, there's plenty of leaks. You know, we don't have that with Mueller. Mueller has been the most leak-proof prosecutor I've ever seen, which I think is really to his credit. But there's all kinds of leaks that come, not always from the government. They come from witnesses. They come from people with interests in things. And if you have a high-profile client, whether it be in the business or the political sense, I mean, you have to fight back and have to get your story out there because the jury pool will be contaminated. And also, people making charging decisions maybe subconsciously or unwittingly influenced by that. And the playing field is not level, as we all know. I think Lara is right. the playing field, I mean, people think everybody's guilty who gets charged, particularly in corruption and white collar cases. So I think you do have an obligation. And as I say, I think that does, being old school, I don't do social media. I'm not on Facebook. I don't even know how Twitter works. But, but I think with the old press and having PR firms involved, which I think can be very helpful. And
Mythili, you're not old school. So what do you think about all this?
I also don't have a Twitter or account at all.
But you got Facebook, right?
No.
No?
No social media at all. Look, I think there's appropriate advocacy that should be, that we all should be entitled to do. But there, we have to weigh that against the notion that there are going to be gag orders from time to time, and that at least when I was at DOJ, there are strict rules about what you couldn't say, besides what was in the charging document and basically what you can say in a press conference. You couldn't say much more. So there is more freedom, I think, by defense counsel to advocate, but I think you always have to weigh that against the notion that there might be a gag order.
So if there is, and Trey, the last half we're going to be getting to you, but because you do talk to the press from time to time, right?
Yeah, but I'm getting my ethics CLE too, and I have a question for Laura.
Go ahead.
You answered the question about what a case is, as that word is used in the rule, but to the extent Mueller is doing both a criminal investigation and a counterintelligence investigation, can he speak and just convince us that it's under the counterintelligence realm and not the criminal? And the other question I have, because you may not call on me again.
Oh, no,
the other question I have is...
We may not agree on much, but I'm going to call on you, I'll tell you that.
Legislators who also happen to be lawyers and hypothetically, this would never happen, but send out an obstructionary tweet or call a witness that you know is going to invoke, something you couldn't do as a lawyer, can you do it as a legislator? So can Mueller talk, but under the counterintelligence realm, and what are the obligations of legislators who happen to be lawyers?
So I'm gonna take your second question first. It's really interesting, and I can't imagine who you might be referring to sending out tweets about, say, for example, Michael Cohen and what might happen to him as a result of testifying in front of Congress. I have no idea who you're talking about. But hypothetically, I think, and I'm really interested to know what Professor Turley thinks about this, I really do think that there's a different standard when you are acting in your role as a congressman or a congresswoman, even if you are, for example, as in your case, barred in, meaning you have a license to practice law in South Carolina. Because when you are acting in a certain way in your congressional capacity, on the Oversight Committee, on the Judiciary Committee, and you're asking questions, and you're making statements, you're not practicing law, per se. You are doing your job that you were elected to do by your district in South Carolina. Now, could there be potentially some sort of ethical violation or potential obstruction of justice investigation into a really stupid tweet? Yes, and apparently now there is. But do I think that that's necessarily appropriate? I'm troubled by it, because I do think that there is a big difference between your traditional role as a lawyer and your role as a congressperson who happens to be a lawyer, if that makes sense. So that's your first question. That's your second question. Your first question is, could Robert Mueller potentially hypothetically speak about a counterintelligence investigation? And I guess I feel that instinctively my response is that he should be subject to the same standards and rules that he is subject to in his other investigation, because we don't know where this counterintelligence investigation is leading, and it may very well lead to criminal charges, in which case I personally think that the less said, the better from the prosecution side, again, because we see how much power these top prosecutors have to sway public opinion. And we can just go back to the original sin of, say, Ken Starr, the constant leaks, the torrid report that reads like, a bad romance novel. Then you can flip to James Comey and his press conference and the belief by many that he really put his finger on the scale of an election. And so what we see is this enormous power, and my instinct is to caution those prosecutors not to abuse it, even in the context, for example, outside the traditional criminal inquiry of, say, an ongoing and somewhat amorphous counterintelligence investigation, but I'd also be very interested, Jonathan, to know what you think about
that. Yeah, so before Jonathan, so for people that didn't listen to the news, probably no one, but Matt Gaetz, a congressman from Florida, the other himself a Florida bar investigation for his tweet and press statement. It wasn't just a tweet, not on the floor of the House, with regard to Michael Cohen on the eve of Michael Cohen's testimony. And the tweet says, "Hey, at Michael Cohen, do your wife and father-in-law know about your girlfriends? Maybe tonight would be a good time for that chat." That's before his testimony. "I wonder if she'll remain faithful when you're in prison. She's about to learn a lot." Do we have an issue with the bar, because he is barred, or does he get a pass because he's a member of Congress, Jonathan?
Well, first, I agree with everything that Laura said. It's a despicable comment. All of us were repulsed when we saw that. But I do think that this is something that is outside the domain of the bar, because it raises countervailing constitutional concerns. I mean, members of Congress have special status in order to do their work. The speech and debate clause is a very good example of the protection afforded under the Constitution. They also have the same liabilities that we have, right? I mean, they just as when we step out of a courthouse, we lose the absolute privilege. They also lose absolute privileges on defamation. You know, when I represented, when I handled the Elizabeth Morgan case, I represented the husband in that regard, Eric Fordish. And I spent numerous television shows trying to get these four members of Congress to repeat what they've been saying about my client on the floor, to get them to say that on television so I could sue them for defamation. And you could almost hear their counsel off camera going, "No. No." And so they kept on saying, "Well, I'll just stick with what I said on the floor." So they can also lose the absolute privilege if you can get them to do it. But this would raise serious problems, in my view, if bars start to enforce these types of ambiguous standards with regard to people who are performing a political and legislative function. I think it would intrude on constitutional issues.
How does the Neil and Mythili, Gary, how does the opening press conference, when the U.S. attorney or, you know, the head of the criminal division or whoever, head of the fraud section, the FBI, a score of other folks display all the accusations of the newly indicted defendant and everything else square with the ethics pretrial publicity rules, 3.6 or 3.8, or the various rules in district court with regard to what we call gag rules? I mean, how does that square? How is that right or fair? And do they have, does a prosecutor who puts on this big show, probably after a dawn raid and, you know, maybe an arrest that might have appeared on TV, does that create ethical problems for the prosecutor?
So I think that there are ways for the prosecutor, for the reasons Laura said, to get around the ethical issues, which is, so long as what they're saying at the press conference is in their speaking indictment, and they've taken speaking indictments to an art form. Although people forget, when you have a speaking indictment, you then have to prove it in court. Yeah. It's not like there's not a consequence to having a speaking indictment. It imposes a greater burden on the prosecutor than in court. But so long as they stick with what the grand jury found in rendering their indictment, I don't think that there's an ethical issue. And on these kinds of cases, they all know to load up their indictment with all sorts of stuff so they can then talk about the press conference. Doesn't quite explain why various different FBI agents and DEA agents and everybody else gets to get up and chat about it. But I also do think, and I think this was one of your points, to have that show and then go to court and say we need a gag order is something that judges should be very suspect of, because they've already done their thing. And the next time they're going to be heard from really is in court. They've done their thing. And then for them to show up and say we need a gag order, they're saying we need a gag order on the defense because they've already spoken. And so I think that's quite inappropriate. And I agree with Jonathan. Although I wanted to say, it seemed to me that Judge Jackson did a really nice, careful job with her gag order. The first one, I think, was quite limited. And then Stone put her picture up next to a... you know, crosshair. I mean, what was she supposed to do? And even on the book, I think what she said was, like, this book didn't just happen in the last 24 hours. How is it that we've had all these conversations about the initial gag order and then the subsequent gag order, and you guys never told me about the book? I don't know
what she was right about that. That they should have revealed the book. I just don't think it should have fall. It should fall within the domain of the gag order. But you're absolutely right. I was surprised that they had not mentioned the book to her.
Yes.
Does anybody think that you know these standard local rules with regard to not making pretrial statements about cases, would that apply to the opening shot from the U.S. attorney?
I mean,
and why not?
I think let me just say, you and I are out of the Southern District, and it didn't take a very serious case before Rudy stood up in a press conference and announced announced it, which is the typical process. We'll get back to Mueller. I think surprising to me, and to his credit, he doesn't even have a press conference or issue a press release when he has indictments. He's got 38 different individuals or entities indicted. Hasn't had a single press conference or a single press release. In fact, I think his only press release was pro-Trump, if you will, which had to do with whether or not Trump had told Cohen to lie to Congress. But then once it was got all confusing once Cohen testified before Congress, because he basically testified that he understood Trump to have told him that. So it was kind of odd that the only actual press release that they ever put out seemed to be a little called into question by what Cohen said.
You know, Neil's point, given the proliferation of media, which is so much more than the old print media when we started, right? There's so much media and there's so many journalists. You don't necessarily need a press conference to get much coverage of something that is important or something that's newsworthy. I mean, I find that Bloomberg and Reuters and all them, they check every filing of any kind of case, and they make calls on their own, as well as the Times and the Journal and the like. And you don't really need a press conference. And there is something, as Neil's saying, a little unbalanced about the big press conference with the charts and the whiteboard and the pointer and all these bureau agents and postal inspectors and SEC people standing behind and everybody being thanked for bringing this terrible criminal to justice and then not being able to say anything back, particularly since, as I think we've all recognized, the public believes people are guilty when they're indicted. When you go to trial on one of these cases, you're trying to level the playing field. The playing field isn't level. So, within reason, why should you be gagged?
So the ethics rule says, I think Laura said you can drive a truck through it, but it basically says you can level the playing field. If somebody says something really adverse, you can come back. So I hadn't committed an ethical violation, but there's a gag rule. Then what happens? I get held in contempt, or do I just make the statement? What do y'all do?
Well, I mean, the gag order isn't going to be entered until you're already way past the
No, but in a lot of districts, there's actually local rules that prohibit you from making statements about cases. I mean, there actually are.
That's right.
What happens? There's this local rule that says I can't make a statement about a case. The U.S. attorney, in my view, has already violated it by having this, show. And the ethics rules say I'm not doing anything unethical. Do I just go ahead and make the statement, or what? Mr.
Pretty
Eggleston?
Bold. Pretty, depending on who the judge is, it's pretty bold to go ahead and make the statement, I think, with local rules like that. And the problem is, and this is sort of your point, which is, it's not like because we're in and Trey knows this better than anybody, we're in such a compressed news zone, things are dead. Within 24 hours, we're on to some other scandal. So it's not like there's time to go to the judge after the indictment and the big show by the prosecutor and say, hey, this is unfair, I need to be relieved from the gag order, because that's happened 2-3 weeks later. And the press doesn't care about you in most of your cases anymore 2-3 weeks later. So there's a I think there's a complete unfairness to that.
Well, there's also a lot of pressure that I had a terrorism case once where we had a standard litigation blog, which is really, you know, old school at this point. It's just having a blog that you would put your filings on. And it's actually the clerks that actually want you to do this, because if you have a high profile case, the clerk's office is inundated with these calls. So the clerk sort of likes lawyers having litigation blogs where you post your filings, right? So we had a very traditional, just post your filings, the stuff that was not classified on the blog. But it had a comment component, so people could comment on it. And the DOJ went into a hearing and objected that these comments were sort of raw and negative towards the government. And the judge actually said, I won't name the judge, but the judge said, I really don't like that. I'm not saying you're in violation of the gag order, but I don't like it. And you're standing there, you're like, you know, wow. I mean, because this is just the filings. We're not making any statement. But I took the blog, I took the site down because I don't want to tick off the judge. And so there's this chilling effect. But in reality, that was not good for my client because the government does get out a lot of information on background with these filings. This is the only way for us to get out our side unless they go through the clerk's office. In a whole high-profile case, it's hard for them to do that. Now we have electronic means so they can go on and get electronically. But still, you know, it's a chilling effect. We pulled it down.
So let's talk about the pre-indictment situation, which Laura tells us the ethics rules don't actually cover, which don't make much sense to me. But should, you know, in the right case, and this is probably the right case, the Mueller investigation, should the social media defense, you know, blitz start long before the charge is ever filed? You don't have to worry about gag orders. Let's just look at Trump and his counsel and what they've said in the media. And, you know, no collusion, witch hunt, 13 angry Democrats, which Trey would not agree with, I think, right, Trey?
I do not.
You really don't, right?
Well, a couple of things there. When I was in the U.S. Attorney's Office, I had Democrats on either side of me, and the only reason I knew they were Democrats is because when I ran as a Republican, they said, you're the only Republican we would ever donate to. We never had a conversation about politics. It never mattered as a federal prosecutor. If you want to be the U.S. Attorney in South Carolina, you better donate to the right president or the right Senate candidate, and that's the way I explain any donations to any candidate is you want to go from an AUSA to the U.S. attorney, and if they're angry, they've done a remarkably good job about not leaking.
Yeah. So, you know, 13 angry Democrats, cooperators are rats, witnesses are all lying, the defendants, witnesses who refuse to cooperate are good men that are being abused, you know, Manafort and Stone. So, I mean, that's the, and what we heard yesterday, and apparently, I mean, I watched it on television after the opening remarks, apparently, from the judge in Virginia was before sentencing Manafort with regard to tax fraud and bank fraud, is there's no collusion. And the opening remarks by the defense lawyer, having come out of court, having achieved, I don't think any of us have ever achieved a variance like that in a fraud case. He didn't say anything that, man, it's some great lawyering happened, because I'd be bragging about that. He said, what did he say? No collusion. So is that, you know, guys, is that the, you know, does that work? I mean, it's obvious, has it worked here that, you know, pre-indictment, this, you know, the defense is out there?
Things to tease apart here. One is, I think with respect to Trump, the jury is out, but surely Rudy Giuliani is playing not only to the audience of the base and not only to the Republicans in Congress, but he's also playing very directly to one person, which is Donald Trump, which leads to kind of the second thing about this whole thing that's so interesting with Trump, with Roger Stone, even with Jared Kushner and Abby Lowell and what happened last week with Abby Lowell having to walk back some of his statements, is that what we're seeing here is what we defense attorneys call a client control problem, which is to say that it is your client who is communicating ceaselessly through social media and going on television with the media. And Donald Trump is not a client who is going to be controlled. And Roger Stone so far has proven to be uncontrollable. And it appears from Abby Lowell's walk back last week that Jared Kushner is quite possibly not telling him the full truth. And so when it is your client who is seizing control of the narrative and creating one public spectacle after another, your strategy has to shift because, in a sense, it's your client who's dictating the terms of public engagement, and it's your job to a certain degree to recognize, okay, I have no client control. What can I do now that is in sync with what my client is doing that is their best possible defense? And, you know, in answer to your question about Paul Manafort, did it work? I feel like the sentence and the judge's reaction kind of speaks for itself. They pushed into the water from the beginning. This is not about collusion. This is not about Russia. You are using Paul Manafort as a tool to try to uncover other information. This is just much ado about nothing, even though Paul Manafort committed a massive fraud involving millions of dollars, and it got certainly to the judge's head. It was in his head throughout the trial, throughout his outbursts and speeches, and it was, as you say, the first thing out of his mouth and resulted in a downward departure that defense attorneys could only dream about, where Paul Manafort, when you do the math, is going to do roughly 3 years instead of dying in prison with a minimum sentence of 19 years.
But doesn't he have a stiffer sentence ahead of him from the district?
Not necessarily. The max for Jackson is 10 years. And
so it doesn't have to be concurrent.
Yeah, she could, but it's, I mean, that would be really going against the grain. There's a real serious question about whether Mueller got played in all this. I mean, when I was surprised when he cut that first, when he cut the agreement with Manafort after Manafort went down in Virginia, because the Virginia stuff was the good stuff. That's the reason they took that trial to Virginia. That was the good stuff. The really bad stuff was in D.C. That's all the Ukrainian horrible, you know, narrative, right, where a jury was going to take him just apart. And so he pleads, and they come up with these two counts. Instead of loading it on the plea and promising a deal on the sentence, they reduce it to a couple of counts, and that's reduced his exposure.
Neil?
Well, look, I don't think I'd ever agree with a sentence that suggested that Mueller got played. I think he's done more of this than I have for a long time, and I'm willing to bet he knew exactly what he was doing, so I don't really sort of follow that. I do think that sort of a couple thoughts about the broader question you talked about, which is, it is, and again, I know there are probably a lot of Trump supporters in the room, but there's a very odd sense in which he's never really regarded himself as the head of government. So it doesn't seem anomalous to him at all that he attacks his attorney general that he appointed. Attacks his DNI head, I don't know if Litt's in the audience or not, whom he appointed. In some weird way, I don't really think he thinks of himself as head of the government. It doesn't care much about the institution. So other presidents would think, well, you know, actually attacking my FBI that's spending a lot of time saving us from terrorism cases and organized crime cases, that's probably not in the interest of the country. But he sort of just basically doesn't really think that way, and I don't think we should ever expect him to think that way, because it's not the way I think he really approaches his job. But the other thing that's been a little surprising to me is, and I think, and Laura sort of referenced this, and you know, it's always dangerous, and we confront this all the time, when we vouch for our clients. Vouching for your clients, right, Gary? I mean, vouching for your clients is a dangerous place to be, because they tell you a story and you go out and repeat it, and if it turns out not to be true, then it's on you, and it's what happened to Abby Lowell, I assume.
To Lanny Davis it happened.
It happened to Lanny Davis.
Sekulow,
the number of times that Rudy has gone out and confirmed some pretty significant fact unequivocally, and later tried to say, well, I was just guessing, or tried to walk it back. It's really quite surprising, actually, I think. So the number of times these lawyers have been out there and have had to walk back, I don't, vouching for your client is a dangerous place to be, but for some reason we've seen this a lot in this case, and they've blown up a fair amount, I think.
What do you think about that?
About vouching for your
client? Yeah, I mean, like Michael Avenatti literally going on 24 hours a day for, you know, talking about, you know, what Stormy Daniels would or wouldn't say, or Lanny Davis talking about what, you know, Michael Cohen would or wouldn't say, or Rudy, you know, repeatedly talking about what happened, and it turns out not to be the case. I mean, what about that?
I mean, look, going back to, I think, Laura's introduction here, there are things that we can do, and there are things that we should decide what we should do. And so I think what we're talking about today is, you know, there's a lot of play in the joints in terms of Rule 3.6. Rule 3.6 only applies to pre-trial publicity, and so what we've been talking about today doesn't fall within those rules. And I think the question is, do you want to do that as a lawyer? Do you want to vouch for facts that you don't know personally, that you haven't investigated yourself? I wouldn't do that.
Is it okay, panel, to, and let's take the two examples, Michael Avenatti and Rudy Giuliani. Is it okay to go on TV literally every day? There's no trial pending, but to talk about a case? I mean, is it okay, a case that you're involved in? I'm not talking about legal commentators. We'll talk about them later, but is that okay? I mean, are we all okay with that?
So, if you're looking at me.
Well, I am now because I can't see anything. Well, okay.
So, actually, I sort of have a view. I don't go on TV. I've never, even whether I'm in the case or not in the case, I know Jonathan does. Neil Katyal, interestingly, has decided that he's going to do a lot of it. He's a very talented lawyer, and I haven't had a chance to ask him why he's decided to do it. I think I don't do it partially because I think I want clients on both sides of the aisle to hire me, and if you get yourself all aligned with one side or the other, I think in a public way like that, so I don't really do it. The thing, in some ways, you got to admire Lanny Davis, who ultimately just said, you know, I'm not actually acting as a lawyer. And when Rudy's going on all the time, and when Avenatti all the time, they're really not acting as lawyers. And so, I mean, they are lawyers, but they're PR flacks. And at least Lanny sort of had the courage to say, look, I'm basically a PR flack. And when I go on, right? I mean, he's in. And when Rudy's doing this, and with Avenatti's doing this, I care sort of less about Avenatti, but when Rudy's doing this, he's just being a PR flack. He's not actually being a lawyer. And as I say, if he were a lawyer, I think he would be more careful about the facts that he articulates.
Well, Jonathan wrote in an article, he said the quote, I'm quoting you now, Jonathan, line between lawyer and media flack, a dual role that is highly valued but dangerously blurs what should be bright line representation. What did you mean about that, and how does this apply to what we've been watching play out?
Well, you know, I think that, I think Lanny, who's a friend of mine, does really walk a dangerous line often because it is not clear whether Lanny is acting as a flack or as an attorney at any given time.
I agree with that.
And if you don't know which you're doing, then you're doing something wrong. I mean, you need to have absolute clarity as to your role at every single moment, particularly when you are in the national spotlight. With Michael Avenatti, I should say he's a former student of mine. He was actually a former research assistant. So was Kellyanne Conway, so I'm on both sides. But in Michael's favor, I would say two things. First of all, he's a damn good trial attorney. I mean, he has had some massive cases, and he is very good in a courtroom, just as he is outside. Second, he did change the profile of the case. He went very aggressive in terms of the public media, but he also had a very difficult case to deal with this confidentiality agreement, non-disclosure agreement. Did he go too far? Probably. Yeah, I think he did, but he also did basically reshuffle that deck, and he ultimately did come out ahead. Now, there was a ruling yesterday that they would, 130 has got to go back to Cohen, and maybe, I think, some attorney's fees. But that was a lot better of a conclusion than what was being anticipated at the outset, largely because the other side fell apart under the glare of the attention that he created. Now, does that mean that he should have done it the way he did? No, I probably would have done it differently. I mean, he was overexposed. There was a lot of saturation problems. But going public was probably the right decision. It's just the degree to which he did it.
But I thought what Judge Wood in the Michael Cohen hearings in New York was very upset with Avenatti. I mean, she was not, I mean, ultimately, he withdrew his pro hoc vice application, but I think she was not going to allow him to appear pro hoc vice because of the way he behaved. And, you know, this issue of, you know, fighting back and all the rest, I guess, you know, I just come from the school, if you're a lawyer, you're a lawyer. And the most important thing about being a lawyer is your credibility, right? And your credibility with, if you're talking to the public area, with, say, start with journalists. I mean, journalists don't trust you if you don't tell them the truth. It's one thing to say, I can't talk to you about this, or I'd rather not comment. But if you tell them something, it better be true, or else they're not going to believe you. The same with the courts, right? The judges see you out there saying things, whether it's in court or out of court, which aren't accurate, they're not going to rely on you when you make representations to the court about things. So it seems to me that, you know, it's one thing to fight publicly for your client, but if you're going to cross the line and become a media person, media flack, whatever that term means, I think it may well end up undermining your ability to function as a lawyer, which ought to be your first calling, right?
And
right,
I think just touching on that point, and then I want to make sure that I let you respond.
No, that's fine.
Is that I think that there's what is also happening because of all of this media saturation and attention is that attorneys, I think, maybe are flying a little bit too close to the sun, like Michael Avenatti and Rudy Giuliani, where to some degree maybe they're losing sight of the fact that their primary obligation is to zealously represent their client and to do nothing to harm their client. It's not about how many times they can get on TV, how much attention they could get and building up their own brand. And I think that those things are really kind of colliding with each other and creating all kinds of complications. And going back to this point about your credibility and your reputation ultimately being the most important thing, I think we've seen both of them take tremendous hits because we're talking about people who were known to be extremely talented, extremely fervent, extremely effective litigators, and they're being publicly denounced by people close to them saying, you know, Rudy Giuliani, I don't even know him anymore. Michael Avenatti sort of turning into this publicity, the word that I'm saying, I'm thinking in my head, I can't say out loud to this audience. But that's my point, is that you really have to, at the end of the day, be down for your client. And you're not helping your client if you are eroding your own reputation or you're so out for yourself because all you can see is like being under the Klieg lights of CNN and having millions of people watching you, that you're losing sight of what your case theory is, what your narrative is, and how best to help your client.
I don't have any disagreement with that. The one thing I wanted to throw in that I was particularly concerned with in this whole business, I do think a lot of people cross the line here, and it did bother me, as my column reflected. But the one thing that we haven't talked about, which I think is a very serious problem for us, is what Lanny Davis did after Michael Cohen effectively flipped. And that is, he created this GoFundMe site. And if you look at, after Cohen flipped, virtually 100% of the interviews that both Cohen and Lanny Davis gave flogged the GoFundMe site. And hundreds of thousands of dollars were given to Michael Cohen, which strikes me as being absolutely insane. But you know, these people, but what concerned me about these GoFundMe sites, and they're not the only ones, right? You had McCabe and others go create their own GoFundMes, is that it gets
Stone,
very
probably.
Close.
I mean, Stone, do you think? Or
yeah, but what concerns me is it gets really close to buying a witness. That is, what Davis was pitching was Michael Cohen can damage Trump. And the minute that message got out, hundreds of thousands of dollars were given to Michael Cohen. And what concerns me is the ethics of that, where you're essentially allowing the public to participate in litigation by effectively purchasing a witness, by giving a witness hundreds of thousands of dollars on the assurance that they're going to harm someone that they don't like. And there is no ethical rule dealing with that. And I find it fascinating and I find it a bit chilling of how that plays out, how that affects witnesses.
So before we go, I just want to ask one ethics issue. There is another rule, which is 8.4, that prohibits, among other things, a lawyer from engaging in conduct involving dishonesty, fraud, deceit, and misrepresentation. Does that rule get implicated by some of these statements that some of the lawyers have made you know, in the Russia investigation that you know, if they were intentionally not true?
So it's a very high standard to prove, and it's a standard that applies one way when you're making a representation to a judge, right? So if you're in court advocating and you misrepresent something or you perpetrate a fraud on the court, that's extremely serious, which is why lawyers, most of them, try to be very, very careful to make sure that what we say is absolutely accurate and to correct ourselves if it's not. But once you're outside of that realm, it's really quite a different standard. And then the question becomes, you know, were you intentionally trying to, under the rules that we've talked about, 3.6, you know, materially cause prejudice, pollute the jury pool, perpetrate a lie? It's a much, much harder and more amorphous standard, which is why we don't really see anybody suffering the consequences of that. But I'd be curious to know if you disagree with me.
No, I don't. I think
So let's change topics. So, Neil, you were in the Clinton White House, in the White House counsel. And so you have the unique perspective of dealing with the Whitewater investigation that started with our, who hired me in New York, with Bob Fisk, a wonderful lawyer, and ended with Ken Starr. You had that experience compared to what you've seen with Mueller. So can you comment on that? Tell us about that. Tell us a little bit about the strategies, if you had them, to how to deal with Starr, and whether there's any parallel with the strategy that's being invoked by the White House.
Yeah, sure. So I was there, if you remember, and most of you are probably too young to remember, but there was a period of time when the independent counsel statute had lapsed. And so when the Whitewater investigation started, there was not an independent counsel statute, and so Attorney General Reno appointed Bob Fisk at the request of President Clinton, actually, not the name, but had asked for an independent counsel to be appointed. Bob Fisk was appointed. And so we had early conversations about, well, how are we going to deal with Fisk? How are we going to deal with him publicly? He has had as outstanding a reputation as any lawyer in the country. He'd been the U.S. Attorney in the Southern District of New York for 8 years, I think. Or at least a significant.
No, it was less than that, but
he was a Republican, as I remember. He was a Republican, although not an active Republican. And the decision basically was, it was sometimes hard to guess, but nothing was going to come of Whitewater. And, you know, ultimately nothing ever did come of Whitewater with regard to the Clintons. It was going to get investigated, nothing was really going to happen, and our interest was in cooperating with him, get the whole thing over with, because that's likely the way. So then the independent counsel statute is passed, and I told the president, this is a terrible idea. Among other things, it had a sunset in 5 years, which would be roughly the end of his second term, so that it would never apply to the next president. This was a statute that was only ever going to apply to President Clinton, unless it got extended again. And so Ken Starr, the three-judge panel, we were hoping the three-judge panel would just reappoint Bob Fisk, but appointed Ken Starr. And really the discussion turned to when do we attack him, frankly. He was a partisan Republican. He was completely unqualified for the job. He had never had any criminal experience whatsoever. I know Sol Weisenberg is here in the audience. Apologize in advance. You did. But Ken Starr had absolutely no experience in this area at all. And as I say, was a partisan Republican. And so there was discussion about when are we going to go after him? And the decision, unlike with Mueller, was we were going to wait until he started making mistakes. And very quickly, he started making mistakes. It's just remarkable that there's this attack on Mueller, who essentially never says anything to anybody ever. And Ken Starr and his investigation leaked every fact they got as fast as they could get it out the door. It was just a massive leak. Their PR guy was ultimately charged with criminal contempt of court for releasing grand jury material. I think he was not convicted, but was actually charged with contempt of court for releasing grand jury material. And if you compare the way that Ken Starr conducted his investigation as against the way Mueller's conducted his, it's just sort of night and day. So we were fairly confident that Ken Starr would start to overreach, but we waited until he overreached before we started to attack him. Obviously, the decision by this administration was to attack, you know, Comey, Trump, Rod Rosenstein, Sessions from day one. And look, I think maybe Trey said it or maybe Gary said it, you know, they obviously have a very different audience. They're not thinking about they're not thinking about a court. They're thinking about 2020, they're thinking about their base, They're thinking about Fox News, and so they're not, I think we're thinking about it in terms of ethics rules, but they're not thinking about it in terms of ethics rules, because that's not where their battle is sort of getting fought. But we made a different decision, but as I say, we went after Star, and unfortunately, there's always a disadvantage to have, in some ways, there's so many issues with Trump that nobody can ever focus on one. I mean, with Clinton, as soon as Monica Lewinsky came along, there was sort of one issue. Everybody kind of knew what it was. It was easy to understand, and so the public was able to absorb it and sort of react to it.
So, Trey, as a prominent Republican, member of all those committees, when you were in the House, what did you think of the strategy that Neil just outlined that started literally from day one by the president to attack the credibility of Director Mueller and his team, and the FBI, and pretty much, and the Attorney General?
Well, there are multiple camps, even within the Republican side. I always thought the best strategy, you know, President Trump, in one of his conversations with Director Comey that was then memorialized in a memo, said, "I did not collude with Russia, but if anyone on my campaign did, I want you to find out." That's not a verbatim quote. I think he used the word satellite, but that's what he meant. "I didn't do it. If anyone did, I want you to find out." I've never seen any evidence the president ever met George Papadopoulos or Carter Page. So to me, the strategy was always, "I don't know who these two guys are. If they did something wrong, more power to you. Go find out." And I would have focused on what Comey said before the Intelligence Committee, which then led to Rod's memo. Yet he cited what Comey testified to before the Intelligence Committee in that foundational jurisdictional memo, which was, what did Russia do in 2016? And with whom, if anyone, did they do it? And I would have supported Mueller 100% on the first prong. What did Russia do? I would have made that an American issue and not a Republican versus Democrat issue, because, you know, I was on Hipsy, Burr just spoke, I've read all the indictments. I have not seen evidence of collusion between the campaign and the Russian state. I mean, you can argue that the Trump Tower meeting was a willingness to collude, but in terms of what would scare me the most if I were one of the president's most ardent supporters, I never saw the evidence of it. So why you are attacking someone that may wind up exonerating you never made any sense to me. But I've only met the president once. I've only talked to him once. I was not one of his closest confidants. And I can tell you, within the Republican Party, there was a real discussion about, you know, you got the Paul Ryan, kind of John Ratcliffe. That was a camp that I was in. And then you had a different camp that was just attacked nonstop on a daily basis, regardless. And I think it makes you look guilty as hell. And I think a different strategy would have been more productive.
You know, Gary?
I say this from afar, because I have had no involvement in either. But one of the things I didn't understand about the strategy of the current administration is his then counsel, John Dowd and Ty Cobb, who are reputable, respected lawyers, who I know, had a full cooperation strategy with respect to privilege waivers, production of documents, and the like, which is completely antithetical to attacking. And it struck me just from afar, you got to go one way or the other. I mean, if you're going to do all the cooperating, which, you know, may well be the right strategy, you should be bragging on that. You should be doing what Trey just said. Look, we got nothing to hide. But there wasn't very much coming from the Oval Office taking any credit or any, you know, wrapping themselves around, you know, we got nothing to hide, we've waived every privilege. And if you're, on the other hand, if you're really going to say, you know, apropos is, you know, we're going to dig our heels in, whether it be in the Clinton one or the Trump one, you should be asserting executive privilege. You should be, you know, as long as you have a legitimate, you know, good faith basis for it, you shouldn't be just turning everything over. you know, as I say, it was sort of struck me as peculiar that the White House counsel shows up for 60 hours of interviews with, you know, Mueller's office. That struck me as kind of weird. I'm not sure that, you know, Bernie Nussbaum would have been showing up for 60 hours of interviews.
Not down Neil Eggleston would have been.
Neil Eggleston would have.
I don't think that wouldn't happen.
I think that there is, it's worth noting that two things. One is, actually, your last point is something that's often missed. This White House has waived executive privilege far more than any administration in my lifetime. So with all the pushback, actually in terms of the actual accommodation that the administration has made, they're off the charts. I mean, in comparison to Obama, the administration was all just full bore on executive privilege. But the other thing I want to note is that
and Kathy.
But the one thing I wanted to note is that, and this is, I agree entirely with Trey, that they should have adopted that policy from the very beginning. All of us believe that. None of us could figure out why he was doing and what he was doing. But it is worth noting, the polls do show one benefit from it. I don't think Trump was ever trying to convince people that he was innocent. He was trying to damage an investigation, and he did. The polls show that a significant number of people have doubts about the Mueller investigation. And this unrelenting attacking of Mueller has been hitting below the waterline, and all the polls show that when it comes to how they view the Mueller investigation, over 50% are skeptical about the investigation. And so he has achieved that.
If we are correct that the Mueller report, I say we, if I am correct that the Mueller report does not have substantive evidence of collusion between the president of the state of Russia or the Trump campaign and the highest echelons in the state of Russia, then what have you accomplished by damaging the person that exonerates you?
Well, I guess one answer is, if you think that you're going to get nailed on some of these other things, from transactional crimes and other things, if you damage the investigation, it could blunt the impact with voters, right? So if I never really thought there was a collusion case to be made. I said that from the very beginning. I just don't buy it. I have too much respect for Russian intelligence. I mean, I just don't think... I mean, if you were a Russian spy master, would you collude with Donald Trump and put yourself, you know, one tweet away from utter destruction? I mean,
Or Donald Trump Jr.
Would you have your great conspiracy meeting at Trump Tower with half the media downstairs? I don't buy it. But
maybe they were a little more subtle about it.
Yeah, but I mean, I don't disagree. I'm 100% with you, Trey, in terms of what he should have done. So I don't agree with how he's acted. I'm appalled by how he's acted. But damaging the investigation does have a political benefit to him beyond collusion.
A couple of things. We've talked about Trump and his lawyers, and we've talked about how Mueller has exercised such restraint in his team from leaking or making public comments. But I don't think we can go without at least addressing what many believe are remarkably aggressive tactics of the special counsel and with regard to this investigation and whether that is a problem, an ethics problem or any other kind of problem. And let's take, for example, the Stone arrest, which was the ultimate perp walk, I would say. But this is a guy that everybody knew that he was a target of the investigation, knew it for a long time, and he was a target, as it turned out, of an obstruction and a false statement investigation. The fact that he was taken out early in the morning with a SWAT team, is that a problem, guys?
When he offered to voluntarily surrender.
Yeah, so can we address that, whether that's a problem, not just in this case, but any of our cases? Is it really right that, our clients that have known that they're under investigation for a long time get arrested? Or should, in all fairness, they be treated the way that any other defendant,
it's sort of hard to say this, you know, would be treated by getting arrested.
Can I add two other criticisms to throw into the thing? Because I think that Mueller has gotten a bit of a free pass on his performance. I mean, I thought he was extraordinarily heavy-handed with Manafort in that raid, which he said was not a no-knock, but it sure looked like a no-knock. And, you know, what are you afraid of? He's going to try to flush his laptop down the toilet? These were all offenses that he had already gotten a lot of evidence on. But the biggest problem I have is Mueller has a history of not respecting attorney-client privilege. He had a history of that as a U.S. attorney, and he convicted Manafort in part on the use of his own lawyer against him. And so he put Manafort's lawyer on the stand, and she implicated Manafort in a FARA violation. I am still astonished that the judge allowed that to happen. But he has a certain record in that sense, in terms of not respecting attorney-client privilege and confidentiality. Now, he's been successful. He was successful in this case. But I think that was very troubling.
So are there issues, Neil, and then Gary, Michael?
Well, it's always hard to know what Mr. Mueller knew, right? I mean, I'm thinking about Stone. I mean, he executed search warrants at the same time. And unless we have what he knows, I think it's hard for us to.
Well, he knew there'd be an arrest.
He knew there'd be an arrest, but I don't know what caused that. He's fairly careful. I definitely, just a couple other comments, just talking about Jonathan. I mean, I understand the concern about that, but he litigated that first in front of Chief Judge Beryl Howell and won, and I think he must have won again the district court. So it's not like these aren't things he can do alone, right?
Right.
He needs a judge to agree with them that it's not a appropriate invocation of attorney-client privilege. Look, I agree with you, though, Sandy, if this is where you were headed. Similarly situated defendants should be treated the same, right? I get that drug kingpins are always going to be arrested in a big raid, and there's going to be search warrants, and there are going to be a lot of agents with flak jackets, and there ought to be. People who don't have a risk of flight and who know that the indictment is coming, as Stone well knew the indictment was coming, you think to yourself, there ought to be something that justifies a morning arrest and raid. Again, I'm not, and the default for again, this doesn't have to do with how wealthy they are, it has to do with sort of their circumstances, I think, of risk of flight, risk of destruction of evidence and the like. But otherwise, people should be generally treated the same, and it's a lot cheaper just to send them a summons or call their lawyer. Obviously, Roger Stone had a lawyer, he would have surrendered. But I'm not directly critical of Mueller on this, because I don't know what he knew that may have caused him to do that.
But he did allow Manafort and Gates to surrender.
Right.
But he didn't arrest them.
Don't know what I'm not in a position, because I don't know what's in his head. And unless he may have had some reason to think it, and I'm not going to directly criticize that, but I think generally people should be treated the same, and they shouldn't be punished for being, you know, basically the only words that also come to mind are words I can't say in this public, but you'll all know what words I could use. But I mean, he shouldn't be punished for just being the kind of person that he is, and I completely agree with that.
What do you think, Gary?
Look, I think there's all too much of these arrests and perp walks going on in cases where there's no risk of flight and there's no risk of destruction of evidence. I mean, again, I agree with Neil. I don't know, you know, Roger Stone may not be the most likable guy on the planet, but I don't know the facts as to, you know, what they were concerned about. So, which, you know, they may have had a justifiable basis that he would destroy something or the like.
No, I think that all these factors are the ones that prosecutors will think about: risk of flight, risk of destruction of evidence if there's an obstruction matter underlying the charges to begin with. There's also provisions in the rules about when you can get a no-knock warrant or a before-morning search warrant. And so there are mechanisms for a magistrate judge or a district judge to make sure that a prosecutor is acting appropriately. So again, I don't know what the facts were here, but assume that they
I guess the question is, do you think that it's overly aggressive when you're talking about, regardless of, we can't say the words that we think about, and regardless of that fact, when all he was looking at is a perjury count and an obstruction count? I mean, that's pretty extraordinary.
I think I agree with Neil. Without knowing what what they know, there's no way for us to opine.
So let's talk about what I would describe as the assault on the criminal justice system, and it is particularly meaningful, I think, in light of the remarks made yesterday by Judge Donald, which were extraordinary and challenged us to work hard to deal with the system. What concerns do y'all have? I mean, all of you now, if any, to the state of the criminal justice system in our country from the constant diatribe from the president and some of his counsel and supporters, including people in Congress, Trey, about DOJ, the FBI, the special counsel, intelligence agencies. What concerns do y'all have about what this has done, if anything, to the criminal justice system? I would start with Neil and then anyone else, including you, Trey?
So I'm a believer that these institutions are there to protect us from, as I said before, from terrorism, from organized crime, and from a variety, and that they deserve our support. And frankly, I think they deserve support from the President of the United States. It's been a long time since I've been in AUSA, but I kind of wonder whether in certain jurisdictions the prosecutors are wondering whether they have to call an FBI agent and whether the FBI agent is going to get cross-examined about whether he or she worked on the Mueller investigation. And if they did rotate through the Mueller investigation, whether an AUSA is going to decide, I don't really think I can call that FBI agent because I'm, that's going to be potent impeachment when it shouldn't be potent impeachment. So I don't know, I just think these institutions deserve our support, including the intelligence community, frankly. President just announces, he said it's all well and good, and my intelligence community uniformly believes that North Korea is a nuclear threat, and he says, I don't really believe that. And and then the second, you didn't quite ask this question, but when I was in the White House, we periodically, we had a lot of cases. We won some, we lost some. And we tended to know when we were going to lose them because we knew who the judges were. But I went out of my way to tell the communication staff and the president, we are not going to say we lost because it was a bad judge. And we've seen a little bit this now, Chief Justice Roberts, because then when we win, we only won because it's a good judge. And so we're not going to do that. When the DAPA case got assigned to that judge in Brownsville, Texas, we were going to lose. And we were in the 100% chance we were going to lose. We had no chance. He had a long history of hostility towards immigration. And we were just going to lose. And then we're in the Fifth Circuit, and chances are pretty high that we were going to lose in the Fifth Circuit. And we knew that. We never said that publicly. And it was important to me to respect the institution that we never do that. And they never did. And so we didn't have sort of Bush judges and Obama judges in the Obama administration. And I was very careful, and I think people pretty much adhered. And it was the same thing because I just think those are institutions that have to be respected. And as soon as you say out loud what I was certainly thinking, then it undermines the institutions, and particularly coming out of the White House. I can have this view as a private citizen, particularly coming out of the White House. That's just too powerful a pulpit, and I think it's just inappropriate.
Anyway. Can I put one caveat to what Neil said, and that is I agree entirely with Neil about the attacks on judiciary are absolutely outrageous and wrong and unpresidential. And I'm hoping Bill Barr is going to help correct that. I don't know. I testified at Barr's confirmation, and one thing I said, they asked me, why is he appointing Bill Barr? And I said, look, I don't know what he's getting, but I know what he's getting. And Bill Barr is as deeply connected to the DOJ as an institution as you could possibly get. Now, here's my caveat.
All right.
And that is, as much as I disagree with what the president says, there is criticism that needs to be addressed with regard to the Department of Justice itself. Some of the findings by Trey and others about the actions of the Department of Justice, I think, have been brushed over by a lot in the media. There's some serious questions there about their conduct. A good example of that is Sally Yates. When Sally Yates told the entire department to stand down and not assist a sitting president on his immigration order, I have no idea where she thinks she got that authority or with the ethical basis for doing that. I considered that to be a really outrageous act, even though I disagreed with the immigration order. And so the Justice Department itself in this period, there have been issues here that I think have to be addressed, and part of it is lost because all of us are so upset with what the president has been saying and doing that we don't feel comfortable with even entertaining the idea that the Justice Department itself needs to be scrutinized in terms of its actions.
But can I just push back on this for a second? He is the President of the United States, and if he has issues with the Department of Justice, he has the power to summon all of them to his office and get explanations and demand changes. He runs the Department of Justice. Now, I personally think he shouldn't run individual criminal cases. He doesn't agree with me on that. He wins because he's the president. But he has lots of methods to address that without basically pretending that they don't work for him, which is the way he's
gone. We got along so well until now. but you would go...
Since we've been on other panels, yeah, kind of a shock.
Exactly. But the thing is, you would go ape if he did that, right? I mean, if he actually called everyone in and said, okay, here's my list of things I don't like about you and what you're doing. I don't think that would go over any better than what he has done. That doesn't mean what he's done is correct. But we are talking about some of the serious issues raised by Trey's committee, by other committees. When I look at that as a criminal defense attorney, it does concern me. Some of the things that these, like McCabe and others said in these emails, these are really serious issues. I mean, there are real problems there. It's Sally Yates' decision. I thought that there was radio silence among most lawyers when I couldn't figure out where she thought she got that authority.
Well, can I just talk, I'm sorry, we're gonna do a side debate here, I apologize for this, but Sally, who got her job because I recommended her to the president, so I need to defend her a little bit. Look, she was pretty certain that she would be fired within minutes of that decision. But she just wasn't gonna stand up to it. And then what people also forget is—
Oh, wait, Neil, are you sure that she was on her way out and she went out as Joan of Arc? I mean, you don't think that played into it?
Well, all I meant, she knew she would get fired for that decision, but it was not. She was not going to go along with something that she thought was unlawful. And I just want to remind everybody, 2 weeks later, the Department of Justice abandoned defending the first travel ban. They abandoned it. They did exactly. She said she wasn't going to do it. 2 weeks later, they stopped. They went to travel ban two. They lost. They went to three. They lost. They finally went to travel ban.
All right, so hold on. So now we're going to go back.
Sorry,
to the Mueller investigation, because we have this rare opportunity. Some fairly opinionated folks. So we don't have the answers. But what is the special counsel likely to do with regard to the president? Any chance the president will be indicted? Somebody can address, Office of Legal Counsel opinions and whether those are actually DOJ policies and actually give immunity to the president, while he's president. But is there any likelihood that either in the Southern District of New York or the special counsel is going to indict the president?
Can I answer first just because I want to get in my two cents and then unfortunately I have to step off this magnificent panel. So very quickly, my two cents about this. I think that Bill Barr, I think Bob Mueller, first of all, they have a pre-existing friendship. And second of all, they have a common goal, which is to shore up respect for the integrity of the justice system. Because as we've just been talking about, it's been under such sustained and severe attack. And my sense is that they will follow these memos to the letter. My sense is that the Bob Mueller report, when we see it, will be the anti-Star report. It's not going to be this lurid, pornographic, crazy town novella that we all got dumped on us after Monica Lewinsky.
Well, a novella. It was three volumes, right?
Good point. Yeah. It was like a Tolstoyevsky tome that, it's a doorstopper. It's going to be the antithesis of this. It's going to be spare. It's going to be written in the Bob Mueller language of the indictments. I think that that's what we can expect. I think we can expect something very restrained, no indictment of the president, and adhering to all of the internal DOJ memos. And with that, I'm sadly having to
take
my
leave.
Thank you so much for having me.
So while Laura's leaving, quickly weigh in. And also, maybe somebody can address what happens if Bob Mueller or the Southern District of New York conclude that there's beyond a reasonable doubt information that, that the president committed a crime. They've made that conclusion. They just go, and let's say the president gets reelected. They just let the statute of limitations run? I mean, what the heck happens?
Well, you know, there is a bill in Congress that sought to correct that, that would essentially stop the statute from running during the pendency of a president's term. I testified during the Clinton impeachment on the constitutional standards. And at that time, I said that I think it's absolutely ridiculous that people are saying a sitting president cannot be indicted. There's nothing in the Constitution, nothing in the history, that gives that type of immunity. And it doesn't track that the framers would bestow that type of sweeping immunity on a sitting president and nary mention a word of it at any point. I just think it's hokum. As for those two memos, you know, the Clinton memo, I'm sorry, is dreadful. It's just a really horrible piece of work. The Nixon memo is a little better. But notably, the two memos by the OLC do not say you cannot indict a sitting president. What they say is that academics divide. You know, some of us say a sitting president can be indicted, some of us say he cannot, and they just said, look, it's a good policy position for the Department of Justice, we shouldn't indict a sitting president. That's not the same as being reported as it's clear you cannot indict a sitting president.
Neil?
So I just taught this in my class last week, so I've read those two, and actually there are two other memos. One just came out earlier, I guess late last week, which is the other two memos of interest, is that there is a Watergate memo written by George Frampton to Leon Jaworski about whether a president could be indicted, ultimately concludes that they have a duty to, and this is the Watergate special prosecutor, a duty to indict, or I think they're thinking maybe Jaworski wouldn't want to do that, or do a presentment, which is a report out of the grand jury, which happens somewhat frequently out of the state system, but not so much in the federal system. But anyway, that there's a duty by the grand jury to report what they concluded. And then Charlie Savage of the New York Times last week got, or maybe even Monday, but anyway, got the Star opinion on the same issue written by Professor Rotunda at the University of Illinois, which is a pretty nice piece of work.
Actually,
I think.
It is.
And he concludes that a president can be indicted. And so interestingly, so there are four Department of Justice memos. Maybe not surprisingly, the two by OLC say no, and the two by independent counsel say yes. So
is it possible that Mueller would not follow the policy, or has he been instructed, do you believe, that he has to follow the policy, the OLC policy?
I think the way OLC memos are regarded within the Justice Department as pretty much binding on them, I would be quite surprised if Mueller would conclude that despite those two memos, and I think
also
he would,
it's not his choice, right? It's not his.
Well,
decision,
ultimately, it's
right?
Not his choice. Although, if he were going to do it and told not to, they'd have to, you know, that would have to be reported, I think, to Congress.
Yeah,
least,
I think what's clear though is that for Bill Barr, he's the last person on the face of the planet that would probably go in opposite direction from those OLCs.
I agree.
Because he has a very robust view of executive privilege. It has nothing to do with Trump. He always has had that view.
Yeah. So anyway, that's, I don't know where I finished, but and then the other piece I think that's been insufficiently talked about in this connection, also by the 2000 memo, is the role of the 25th Amendment, which is the basic theory of the opinions is Article 2 vested in the president. If he's on trial or sitting in jail, he can't perform his function, and the framers would not have wanted to give all this power to a single person. Well, the framers, after the framers, is the 25th Amendment, which deals with what do you do with when a president is incapacitated. Now, I know there's no obligation that the cabinet trigger it, but there is a sort of a method of dealing with an incapacitated president, and it seems like a jailed one would be as incapacitated as a sick one.
Or one under an indictment.
Or even one under indictment.
So what do you expect, Trey? Is there going to be a report? Is it going to be a Star-like report? I mean, what do you anticipate? And do you think under any circumstances that Barr will not release the report, or at least that part of the report that doesn't have classified information or other, you know, privileged stuff in it to Congress and to the public? What do you think?
Back when I worked for the department, they did not speak via press conferences or reports. They spoke via indictment. And so to that extent, he's already issued part of his report. He's indicted a whole lot of people. This is where it gets a little bit different. There's a criminal component, which the only way he can speak is through indictment, and then there's the counterintelligence component. But Mueller and Barr are both smart enough to know you have certain evidentiary burdens you have to clear in the criminal realm. So are you going to quote a sentence from a witness interview in your counterintelligence report, knowing full well that Congress is going to come back and ask for the entire interview so they can judge whether or not that comment was in context or not? I think what he's going to do is, if there are more indictments to come, he's going to issue them. He's going to write the seminal authoritative piece on what Russia did and tried to do to this country in 2016. It's going to be heavily redacted due to classification and grand jury considerations, and I think he's going to be very mindful. And I am reluctant to beat up on Jim Comey because he's not here to defend himself, but I think he's going to be very mindful of what Comey did with his press conference, which is essentially indict someone that is not going to be indicted. So how you can include all of this misconduct in a report that doesn't rise to the level of a crime, and it's not his job to provide an impeachment roadmap to House Democrats.
Does he have an obligation to do a report? Is there any obligation, Neil or Jonathan?
Well, the statute does contemplate a confidential report to the Attorney General. The statute is really poorly written. It refers to the confidential submission to the Attorney General and then a summary from the Attorney General. There's nothing that limits Bill Barr from, he could do a number of things. Right? He could give a summary and then scrub the report and attach the report. He could make the report his own. He could put a summary at the beginning of the report and then submit it as a one piece of work. But you got to keep in mind that when this happens, there's some talk about it being today, there's some talk about it being next week. But when it happens, he has to scrub that report. I mean, one of the things that came up in his confirmation hearing with Feinstein and others was they said, you know, he wouldn't guarantee that he'd release the report. And I told Feinstein, look, if he had actually said, I will release the report, I would flip my testimony and oppose his confirmation, because that would be a deeply unethical act. There are about six laws that require him to scrub that report. If he had promised to give you that report, he'd be violating those laws. It's Rule 6E material, which is going to be loaded in this report. Classification laws, there's at least three of them. There's the Privacy Act. All of that he has to scrub out. So that's going to take time. We don't know if Mueller's already done that. So one of the logistical issues is going to be, does he issue a summary right away and say, look, here's the basic findings of the report. We're going to give the committee or the Gang of Eight a classified version under seal, and then we're going to scrub it here, and we're going to try to get that to you. Or is he going to wait, try to scrub it out, put his summary at the beginning? The statute allows him to do all of the above.
So can I just, one sort Absolutely. Of thought of this? So, and you referenced this earlier, and I've sort of wondered as this issue about the report comes up, whether this has been intentional. For the White House people, I think they've largely not gone into the grand jury. I think, in fact, he's not put a significant number of people in the grand jury, and maybe mostly the people who have gone in are the people who have refused to cooperate with them. He doesn't have 6E problems if he's done this pursuant to interviews. And I've sort of wondered whether he's thought through that.
I mean, but he has the, I thought that they had Virginia, they cross-pollinated, I thought, with Virginia. So there is 6E coming from that direction.
Well, I don't mean that there'd be no 6E issues, right. But to the extent that what he's relying on is witness interviews, I think, all I meant was, if he put everybody in the grand jury, it's very hard for him to have anything left. I think he pretty much did everything by interview, which may give him, and I don't mean to prejudge, I don't really know, but it would give him a greater opportunity, I think, to have at least that portion not redacted.
It's going to be tough if it's not released. There's going to be fires.
But tell me if I'm wrong, Neil, but I think that if there is 6E in there, he has to remove it before he even gives it. He can't give 6E to Congress without a separate
unless
order.
You get a disclosure order.
Right, from the court, right? He has to go back to the court.
There's so many other things we can talk about. And I do want to see if people have questions, but I have one more question for you. One other observation. My recollection is, Trey, that the Republicans asked for and received the raw investigative material with regard to the investigation of Hillary Clinton and some other investigations, and in seeming violation of Justice Department policy. Is that right? Y'all got it? Y'all got 302s and other raw investigative
materials? We not only got 302s, we got draft 302s. And the distinction I would make between Secretary Clinton and the ongoing investigation is when you're charged, there are lots of layers of scrutiny and review. There's a judge, there's a jury, there are appellate courts. On a decision not to charge, there is no scrutiny, there is no review. So if your job is to provide oversight over the Department of Justice and they've made a decision not to charge, how else are you going to provide oversight?
But that's sort of my point. So if the Department of Justice has a policy not to charge a sitting president, so he's not going to get charged, then how could the Justice Department not, consistent with what you were about to say was the obligation of oversight, not turn over to Congress for oversight the raw material to analyze
it? I would encourage them to adopt my rule, which is a sitting president can be indicted but not prosecuted, and then they'll hide behind that this is an ongoing investigation policy, which Congress also does not recognize. And that's what got, look, I've defended Rod a bunch, but once you start going down the path of, okay, we're going to give you this and we're going to give you that, Congress will never stop asking for it. They don't even understand why they don't get grand jury material. So the fact that it's an ongoing investigation is not going to matter to Mr. Cummings or Mr. Schiff any more than it mattered to Bob Goodlatte and my friends in the Freedom Caucus who wanted the FISA application, the Woods file. They wanted all of that.
And they got it. And they got that. Right?
They got it. But in hindsight, what Rod should have done was said, okay, you've already got impeachment articles drafted. Go ahead. I just got off the plane with the president. He says he's fine with me. He didn't ask for my resignation. You do whatever you feel like you have to do. But what he tried to do was accommodate a group that cannot be accommodated. They're always going to ask for more. And now we find ourselves with two acting U.S. attorneys screening information to decide what to give to Congress and what not to. You can't close that box once you start giving information about an ongoing investigation.
Do y'all agree? So, if anybody has a question, just come up to the microphone. And I know Bob Litt's out there, and I think he has a question. But while you're walking up, because we can't see anything, does anybody on the panel have a defense for Director Comey's statements, press conference, with regard to the decision not to indict Hillary Clinton and then what he said about it? And is there a defense here for that, Jonathan?
Anybody. It's very hard to defend. I think that you can defend him in notifying Congress that the investigation was reopened because Congress had agreed to hold back to some extent, but there was also an understanding that Comey would keep them informed on
progress. That's the second one.
Right.
The first one.
But not on the press conference. Yeah, it was also just remarkably stupid, and he was likely to be called to Congress, and some of this would probably be asked as to his view of how the stuff was handled. So I don't think there is a real defense.
Anybody?
Trey, do you defend? I would just say bad facts make for terrible precedent. And looking at it from his perspective, you've got the candidate from one major political party under investigation. You have the campaign of another under investigation.
Which had not been disclosed.
It had not. And look, I find myself in a very awkward position of defending Director Comey. But going back to July of 2016, and you have the tarmac, and you have the conversation he had with Attorney General Lynch, and whatever his relationship was with Sally Yates, I am convinced, as wrong as what he did was, that he was convinced himself that he was doing it to preserve the integrity of the department. And we are welcome to impeach his deeply held conviction, but I do believe that's why he did it.
So, and if anybody else has a question, just line up behind Bob. Bob?
So, thanks, Sandy. I want to push back a little bit on Congressman Gowdy's suggestion a couple of minutes ago that congressional oversight of closed individual criminal cases is an appropriate exercise of the legislative function, because I think that that runs the same kind of risks that oversight of ongoing cases does, and I'd be particularly interested in hearing what Mythili and Neil have to say about that concept.
There were times that we briefed Congress on closed cases when I was at the department, but it was in unusual situations, and so it didn't happen all the time.
So, maybe answering a slightly different question. I agree with Trey that Rod just found himself kind of in a box that he opened for himself, which is this is just one. I know the Freedom Caucus guys, they were not going to agree to it. Anytime he gave them something, they were going to ask for something else until they were sitting in the Attorney General's office answering his phone for him. And so I do think this is one where he just had to say, I'm not going to give you anything. Because, it's a pretty, sort of your point, it's a pretty powerful argument. And then Rod, a couple of weeks ago, gave some speech about how important it was that these decisions be immunized from review. And I thought to myself, well, nice time for you to get that idea, right, before the, Mueller report's going to come out. Where were you when Congress wanted all this material earlier that you ultimately decide to give? And look, he would say no, and they would say you have to, and he would say no, and there was that little dance, but he eventually just gave over and over again. And I don't know, I think Rod should have just held the line. And as I said, look, if he gets impeached, he gets impeached, or if he gets held in contempt, he gets held in contempt, sort of whatever happened. But I think as a matter of principle, I completely agree with Trey. I think he should have just held the line.
I've got to disagree. Partially, I represented the House of Representatives, and I'm a typical Madisonian scholar, so I tend to favor Congress, and I disagree. I think Congress has a legitimate oversight role if they believe that a case was closed for political purposes. That is part of their oversight role, and I think it's commendable that the Trump administration has given so much information to Congress, because these questions are deeply disturbing. The American people are very interested in understanding the facts. And so I take the opposite view. I think they do have an oversight role, and I think it's a good thing that the administration's waived this stuff.
I think the way Congress and DOJ interact with each other, it's not a prescriptive set of rules, right? It's a set of accommodations back and forth about what you can produce to Congress, what you can't, whether you make something available and behind closed doors, whether you do a briefing instead of in writing. It's a set of accommodations, and it's all, just fact-based.
I think it's right, yeah.
Mitch?
Gary, can I say one thing?
Oh, yeah.
Rod's not here, but if he were, I think what he would say is there's contemporaneous oversight by the intelligence committees. There is retrospective review by the non-intelligence committees. What made this fact pattern so difficult is the intelligence committees were doing their oversight at the same time. And there happened to be this counterintelligence investigation and the criminal investigation. In days gone by, it would not be unusual for the House Intelligence or Senate Intelligence Committee to know in real time what's happening in a counterintelligence. This, Rod would accommodate this committee, but the information would wind up in the hands of this committee, who then wanted more. This fact pattern, this confluence of counterintelligence and criminal, I think is what led to some decision making that people would like a chance to do over.
Mitch?
I was just interested in what you think the impact was of the origin of and subsequent leak of the now infamous dossier on the strategy that the lawyers adopted for their respective clients.
The dossier, I think it's a really interesting question about how this played out and how it changed how people responded to it. And on this one, I don't mean to be here to constantly be sort of the public defender for the administration, but on this point, they have a point to be made. The dossier was deeply troubling. first of all, the Clinton campaign denied that they had funded the dossier, and there's all this spin about, well, a Republican organization had hired this group. No, the dossier was funded by the Clinton campaign, and they denied it. And after the election, reporters in the New York Times came out and said, we were lied to. And they brought evidence to the Clinton folks, and they finally admitted that they paid it. And by the way, they folded the cost into a legal account. The same type of allegation involving Michael Cohen. The money for the dossier went through their law firm, looked like it was a legal expense. And what did they do with it? They hired a guy to go and get evidence from, among other people, Russian intelligence. Now, does that mean it completes the narrative of Donald Trump? Of course it doesn't. But it also raises many of the same troubling questions about the use of lawyers and about the designated legal funds to hide this type of thing. What bothers me is not the criticism in the media of the Trump administration, because it's a target-rich environment, but I do think that there is a need to also look honestly at the dossier as involving some of the same questions.
So a couple of questions, but before we stop, did the Mueller team ever tell you not to interview a witness?
No, I had one meeting with Bob Mueller. It was very short, and Adam Schiff and I met with him together, and he was a consummate professional, like he always was. We would send a witness list over, and I believe there were occasions where they may have asked us to interview a witness later. But they never asked us not to interview someone, and I would have been surprised if they had. Prosecutors never want multiple interviews of a witness. I'm surprised they didn't weigh in more, but they never did, other than on scheduling.
Was anybody surprised that the Mueller team did not subpoena the president? I mean, why did they forego the opportunity for testimony? Is it just the hassle of having to go to court, or what?
My sense was, Nixon resolved the issue in connection with documents, but the issue of whether...
Well, Clinton, civil deposition, right?
Yeah, civil deposition, but I think treated somewhat differently. But anyway, I think that was an open issue. I think they suspected that if they did that, the litigation would go on and on over it, and they'd never get done. They got the answers to the written questions. I think they probably just decided that they didn't really need it. It may, I'm guessing, to be very clear, it may tie into their conclusion that they can't indict him anyway, and so their need for knowing what was actually in his head was less, and that they thought maybe just getting the written answers was sufficient. That might have been the way I would have thought about it. But mostly, I think the litigation would have gone on for quite some time, and it would have distracted from the work that it would have sort of turned it into a different kind of a PR.
So point. You're the pardon expert. Can the president pardon himself?
So to borrow from Mr. Turley here, there's nothing in the Constitution that says that he cannot. I think academics and others are divided on that issue. I think that more academics think that he cannot than think that he can, but I don't think there's an answer to that question.
And y'all's prediction on two things, and then we're done. Will there be an impeachment proceeding, and will there be pardons? Jonathan, quickly.
Well, I know on impeachment, I just did a column on this. If they're going for an impeachment, this is not the way to do it. The 80 subpoenas they just sent out is not the way to do it. They've got basically a sweet spot of a year. No one is going to tolerate an impeachment months before an election when the president's on the campaign trail. They've got about a year. You have no idea how long it takes to get an impeachment. I was the last lead counsel in an impeachment trial. I represented Judge Porteous. That was considered an easy impeachment because it was investigated by the courts and just given to the House representatives. My opposing counsel was Adam Schiff. It took 17 months for us to get to finish the Senate trial. 17 months on what was considered easy impeachment. We're about 22 months away from the election. So if they want to do an impeachment, this is not the way to do it. If they want to follow Watergate, they have to focus on a smaller number of issues while he was president, and avoid subpoena fights. Focus on fights that you can win in the short term. And that's not what the Democrats are doing. And I don't believe the Democrats want to impeach him. I think the last thing they want is to remove Donald Trump. They want to wound him, but they don't want to impeach him.
Neil?
I suspect, and again, just to make a distinction here, he could be impeached by the House a lot faster than he could be convicted by the Senate. So, I mean, they think they could get through the House.
It depends on the model, right? If they go with the Clinton approach, they could do it real quick.
Yes, exactly. Right. Although they're not, they may well not have the, what Laura called the salacious, a huge report to go on.
They don't have the dress.
They don't have the dress. So I suspect not, frankly. I suspect that what they're going to do is investigate various different issues, bring light to the various different issues, and attempt to defeat him in 2020. That would be my prediction.
And how do y'all feel?
I'd like to defer answering that question until after I see what Mueller comes forward with.
Assuming you see what Mueller comes forward with.
No, but I think we'll see
something.
We'll see whether we see it all, we'll see enough. I mean, if Mueller's findings are this, it's one thing. If Mueller's findings are this, I think it's another thing.
What about the Southern District of New York?
I think we'll wait on that one, too.
Trey? I have no idea what evidence special counsel has. I don't think there'll be pardons, and I don't think anybody's been sentenced to enough time to get a sentence commuted. So I don't know what Mueller has. I don't know what the Southern District has. Based on what I've seen so far, the House Democrats know there would not be a conviction if they were to impeach. So I think they're smart enough not to do it.
I'm going to take my own counsel and not speculate about facts I don't know. So,
it's been a wonderful conference. Thank you very much. This was a great panel.
That was fun.